We're a nonprofit, and our mission is to challenge, conceive, model, and educate about a new economics that supports both people and planet. We believe it's possible, and I see the need more clearly every day. We work in theoretical and inspirational venues like this, and also with really good, tangible, on-the-ground projects. So if there's anyone in the room that's new to us, if you're doing something and you need our help or our advice or support, please don't hesitate to reach out. And in that regard, I'd like to introduce everyone to Susan Witt, the classy one in the back with the white suit. Susan has been the executive director of Schumacher for over 30 years and really is the energy and the brains behind this operation. I'd also like to thank Gordon Thorne, who through his nonprofit and his support of us is really as much responsible for us being here as anybody else. Where's Gordon? Thank you. And to our sponsors today, the Open Center, super cool, and Ben and Jerry's. So there will be ice cream after lunch, if you're good. I want to get a feel for who's in the room. So how many have been to Schumacher Lectures in the past? Good. I like new. And how many have read Small is Beautiful, Schumacher's book that started all this? And how many, I'm going to say kids are here on the student youth program. All right. If you have a good time, your assignment is you have to go home and read that book. It's only like 50 pages. It's this big. Buddhist economics will change your life. Most importantly, though, how many people think this room is a little too nice for a discussion of a new economics? But we have an excuse. For that, we have to thank our board member, Dale. Where's Dale? The other classy lady in the back. I'm going to embarrass her. Dale actually lives upstairs. I spent the morning trying to remember. Who's 50? What TV show was that? Family Affair, Courtship of Eddie's Father. I don't know, but she's living that life, but she's giving with what she does and has, and it's spectacular. So she underwrote, arranged, sponsored, beautified, classified today for us. So thank you so much, but we're embarrassed. So this is not the norm. You know, we'll see you in the barracks next year for the next election. So the invitation for today was America, Emerging Culture and Economics. And I'd like to read a paragraph from the invitation because I thought it was pretty well written. I had nothing to do with it. So the first annual E.F. Schumacher Lectures were delivered in 1981 by Wendell Berry, Wes Jackson, and Hazel Henderson. It's like the 27 Yankees. That wasn't in the invitation. The theme was people, land, and community. The speakers emphasized the importance of vibrant regional economies at a time when the focus of our nation was on expanding the global economy and the U.S.'s role in that economy around the world and taking over everything. So that global economy has failed us in its promise. A growing number of organizations of all kinds are realizing that the current economic system is standing in their way of achieving their objectives, whether they're environmental, fairness, equitable distribution of wealth, or respect for your unique cultural traditions. That's why they're turning to an economics that's just and recognizes planetary limits. To my way of thinking, whatever your issue is, the economic system really is the core. I'm a mathematician, and when I turned full on to doing something that mattered besides running my business, I really took a year to figure out what to me really matters. And my conclusion was systematically, it's the economic system that causes the environmental problems. It's the economic system that causes the lack of education. It's just an allocation of resources. It's the economic system that causes unfairness between communities. So I live in Westport, Connecticut. Next door is Bridgeport. We live in the most unfair county in the country, and it's all about the money. And so I found this organization, and I'm really happy to be working on something as really hard as it sounds that I feel is core and central and transformative to all the problems in our culture. So today's program, though, is to hear from people that actually know what they're talking about. So that's Otto Scharmer, Van Jones, and Judy Wicks. And these are three just spectacular, towering intellects in this space. Judy is our MC, and I'd like to say a couple words about Judy. Well, first, in her own words, this is intense. In her own words, her lifetime has been focusing on local living economies, responsible business, and the role of the feminine in building a new economy. I'm like, just put them in charge, and it'll all be good. I'm with you 100%. She founded the White Dog Cafe, which is maybe one of the best known earliest socially responsible businesses, and in her own way tried to make money and do good. She pioneered environmental practices, clean energy practices, fair trade, fair wage, and got a lot of attention, New York Times, Wall Street Journal, Newsweek, US News, Fortune, Washington Post, and like the whole rest of the world for trying to do both, make money and do good. It's still really hard. And so what most people don't know also about Judy, she's a prolific businesswoman who started other businesses, other organizations, and 10 years ago started BALLE. It's their Business Alliance for Local Living Economies. Does everyone know BALLE? BALLE's a really big deal. It's 30,000 companies around the country and in Canada all trying to do this local, thoughtful, conscious business. And I don't know, I think that's kind of a big deal. So for her work, she's a recipient of many awards like the James Beard Foundation's Humanitarian of the Year Award and Philadelphia Sustainability Award for Lifetime Achievement, Inc. Magazine's Best Small Company to Work, and Oprah. That's super cool, getting an award from Oprah. Amazing, gifted, and giving food, gifted and giving, I think kind of works for me when I think of you. So, but she's also, very importantly, a published author, very active speaker and inspirer. And Judy and the other speakers today all have books, recent books that are here. So during lunch and afterwards, if you'd like to get your book signed and so forth, that will be available. And I guess when I think of Judy, I'm new to you, so we only know each other a couple of years, but so all the stuff you did is great. Like, I'm a grunt, and projects and work and getting your fingernails dirty is absolutely critical, but when I see you interacting with people, you're just flat out inspirational. Like, you just show up and you change all the energy in the room. And I think it's partly, and this is what Schumacher tries to do. We try to do enough on-the-ground projects that we are real, that we have credibility, that we have done the work. We're not just talking about it. But then to think really deeply about it and put it in a structure, you know, where you can feel like you're a part of something. And I don't know, to me, you represent that. You're kind of a force of nature. And it's just always better when you're in the room. Thank you so much. Judy Wicks.
Thank you, Dan. This is a sumptuous room. But look, we can see the sky. Doesn't that make us feel at home? So thank you to Susan and the Schumacher Center for bringing us all here today as we reimagine the American economy. So look out, New York. We're here. The Schumacher people have come down from the hills. The shoe people down from the Berkshires. And we're here to change the American economy and the global one, too, because the old one doesn't work for us. Because it doesn't work for everyone. It's gotten too centralized and too top-heavy. Doesn't that sound like the Soviets? So we're going to decentralize. We're going to create more owners, more small business owners, retailers, manufacturers, distributors, more worker owners, more artist owners, more public owners of our commons. It's going to be more fair, more green, and more fun, too. And we've got our own money. Show them the money, Alice. The Berkshires. And Ben Cohen is here, and he will be stamping money over there as part of his stamp stampede to get money out of politics. And if you have your money stamped today with things that say things like not to be used for bribing politicians, you will, and you buy a stamp to do the rest of your money, then you'll actually get a coupon for a free pint of ice cream. So you tycoons out there that have been used to getting things your way, look out, because we're getting money out of politics and we're changing the economy, so get used to it. Change is a coming. Place. Place is a concept of great meaning to the Schumacher community. And this place where we are this morning is an island. It's a place that was once called Manhattan by the Native American people, which means the island of many hills. When the Europeans arrived here around 1600, they found a wilderness that rivaled the most beloved of our national parks and environmental splendor. A natural landscape of hills and valleys, fresh water, wetlands, salt marshes, beaches, lush green forests crisscrossed with streams, and a beaver pond where Times Square is today. Hard to imagine now, it was the home of multitudes of wolves and wildcats and bears and otters and minks and birds, and there was clear water jumping with fish and porpoises and whales in the harbor. The first people who made this their land were called the Lenni Lenapes, which means in their language, human beings, or original people. The Lenni territory stretched from the headwaters of the Delaware and the lower Hudson Valley down through western Long Island, all through New Jersey, eastern Pennsylvania, to the north shore of Delaware, including my own community of Philadelphia, where we would have a Native American dinner every year at the White Dog Cafe and give thanks to the Native Americans for the many foods in our diet that were first cultivated by Natives. Today, we are in a place no longer called Manhattan, but rather Manhattan, one of the five boroughs that makes up New York City. This place, once strong in its natural diversity, now finds character and strength in its cultural diversity. New York City has been described as the cultural center of the world, and it's also the financial center of the global economy. What better place to explore a new American culture based on the values of cooperation, generosity, and harmony with our natural world, exemplified by the First People? And as we sit on the brink of an environmental disaster and the social disaster of rising inequality, what better time and place to be reimagining a new American economy that works for all? As the speakers of the first Schumacher Lecture in 1981 articulated, we envision this new economy as a network of vibrant regional economies comprised of locally owned, human-scale businesses committed to the health and well-being of their communities and their ecosystems. These regional economies produce basic needs locally, food, energy, clothing, building materials, bringing economic power to our communities, spreading business ownership and wealth more broadly and fairly. We envision a global economy as an intricate network of small-to-small fair trade relationships, trading what we have in surplus for what we can't produce locally, and exchanging what is unique to our region, be it a fashion design, a fine wine or cheese, artwork, music, an entrepreneurial invention, or any of the other things that celebrate what it is to be human. Global warming brings urgency to this work. Not even mighty New York City can hold nature at bay, as we witness with Superstorm Sandy. Not only must we end our addiction to fossil fuels and reduce carbons in a race against time, but we must also prepare our communities for the inevitable consequences of climate change by ending our dependency on long-distance shipping routes, easily disrupted by severe weather and social upheaval. Producing basic needs locally becomes a matter of survival. Rising inequality is making us a nation of haves and have-nots. Large corporations control much of our wealth, as well as our government. Many people are suffering, and our democracy is at risk. Building a just and sustainable regionally-based economy rooted in community is not a utopian dream. It is key to saving our democracy and our very survival as a civilization. Our two speakers today, Otto Scharmer and Van Jones, both people I love and admire, bring to us deep wisdom and passion that so desperately is needed in these urgent times of great opportunity. When I thought about introducing them today, what came to mind was the legendary story of the founders of the Iroquois Confederacy, which created a peaceful democracy among five tribes of Native people in the territories just to the north of the Lenni Lenapes in the northern woods. This story should take about an hour to tell, as I first heard it when Jean Houston told it, but I'm going to make it short. At that time, somewhere between the 11th and the 15th century, there's a dispute about that, these five Native nations were fighting amongst each other. There was alienation and anarchy and terrorism and even cannibalism, a culture of violence. As exists among some in our own country today, there was a them and us mentality, an every man for himself, kill or be killed attitude driven by fear, and a worldview that survival depended on domination and competition rather than cooperation and partnership. From this culture arose two leaders who brought a message of community trust, cooperation, equality, peace, and friendship. Spreading this message among the nations, they were successful in uniting them into a democratic union, the Iroquois Confederacy, which eventually provided a model for the US Constitution and for democracies around the world. The first of these men, referred to as the Man of the North, or the Peacemaker, saw that in order to bring transformation, there needed to be what he called a new mind. And this new mind was a radical change in consciousness that crossed the great divide of otherness. When I think of Otto, I think of his concept of bringing into being a new mind, that makes transformational change possible. The other man was called Hiawatha, not the Hiawatha from the Longfellow poem, by the way, but the original man by that name. Hiawatha was a great orator, and he was the spokesman in bringing to the divided nations a vision for a new society of unity and peace, where equality and human dignity prevailed. Hiawatha reminds me of Van Jones and his gift as an activist and passionate orator in articulating his vision for a new American dream. Like the two men who brought democracy into the world some 600 years ago, today's speakers are significant contributors to the transformation underway, the evolution of mankind to a higher state of consciousness that opens itself to a new economy and a new order of health, justice, and peace in America and beyond. So Otto will be speaking first. He is formerly known as Dr. C. Otto Scharmer and holds a PhD degree in economics and management from Witten-Herdeck University in Germany. I met Otto first by phone when he called me some 5 years ago while he was researching for his latest book, Leading from the Emerging Future. In his book, he talks about the importance of moving from ego system awareness, only concern with benefiting me, to eco-system awareness, concern with benefiting all, including myself. Or simply put, moving from me to we. Otto included my own story of moving from me to we in his book, a story in which I made the decision to share my farm supply sources with my competitors in order to build a whole local food economy that shared my values. Otto so beautifully articulates this concept of cooperation and sharing, which is fundamental to building the new economy we envision. His best-selling books, Theory U and Presence, explain the concept of presencing, learning from the future as it is emerging. Otto is a senior lecturer at MIT and the founding chair of the Presencing Institute, which has training and research sessions for executives and activists on how to develop the disciplined, evolved consciousness needed to advance the transformation of our economy. Otto chairs the MIT Ideas Program and helps groups of diverse stakeholders from business, government, and civil society to innovate at the level of the whole system. He co-founded the Global Well-Being and Gross Happiness National Happiness Lab, which links innovators from Bhutan, Brazil, Europe, and the United States in order to evolve and innovate beyond GDP. Michelle Long, the executive director of BALLE, was a participant in Otto's program, traveling with his group to Bhutan and elsewhere. And here is what Michelle says. I admire Otto's ability to speak with great academic rigor about the deepest, most important ideas, those that have been historically in the realm of the mystics. He can meet with the big banks of Europe or the Chinese government leaders and with great clarity say that the most important leadership capacity of our times is in essence about recognizing our interdependence. Please join me in welcoming the me to we guy, Otto Scharmer.
Thank you, Judy. Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Susan, and everyone else who contributed to this event and series. It's a great, I'm humbled kind of being part of that, and I would like to share a little bit from my own experience to contributing to what we all care about and what you so beautifully articulated. I would like to begin with an observation that looks at many of you, many of us, started this work many years ago. Today, when you talk about being that we have entered a time of disruption, that we are in a crisis, not only economically, but also in terms of our civilization, where something is ending and something else is wanting to be born, you hardly meet anyone doubting that. Yes, we can, you know, maybe have different views on some of the deeper root issues, what needed to change or not, or what is it actually what's kind of wanting to emerge. But I find it interesting when you work with people at the very top or at the grassroots level, across systems, sectors, and cultures, this, the sense of that we live historically in a moment of disruption, where something is ending that we can describe pretty well, different angles, yes, but it's the same thing. And something else is beginning to emerge that yet we cannot fully get our arms around. This sense is very widely distributed, and it's like we almost take it for granted. But let's think about when you brought, when you go here on a stage like this, and some 10, 15, 20 years ago, you say the same thing, everyone would have challenged you. No longer. Now it's like obvious. The question is, what do we do about that? I think that's a major shift. It's a major shift that not only applies to how we think about the current transformation of capitalism and kind of the disruptive changes we are part of, it also applies kind of to some of the deeper strands, kind of the deeper issues related to mindfulness, related to the new mind that is necessary. And when I think about, what probably unites all of us here is that we sort of believe that, yes, kind of we all can describe the surface symptoms of the current crisis that we are in, but what really are the root issues here, the root causes? And I would say kind of probably the most important root cause starts right between our ears. It starts with our own thinking. In particular, it starts with our paradigms of economic thought that somehow have lost touch with the reality around us. And while there are like two major areas of blind spots in the current paradigm of economic thought. One is externalities, and we have talked about that one a lot. But the other one is what I would call consciousness. And that's almost not talked about at all. So that's what I want to put a little bit more centrally into the conversation. And I happen to believe that at the root of our current economic transition and transformation that we are in really is a shift from an old paradigm of economic thought that basically revolves around ego system awareness to a new one that basically revolves around ecosystem awareness, by which I mean kind of focusing on the well-being of all and the well-being of the whole. And it is surprising that in economics, that mainstream economics, it doesn't play a role, because if you look in any real company, that's actually what managers do. What leaders and managers do today is that you take stakeholder groups, in our real work, that's what we do. Kind of we move stakeholder groups and from a state of connection and transaction where that's mainly framed by ecosystem awareness, where I just see my own angle of it, and in all kind of processes and conflict resolution and kind of developmental efforts that we have, it's basically moving to a stakeholder or an ecosystem awareness where I more internalize the impact that my actions have on my collaborators on the other side. So I'm not talking about an utopia. I'm not talking about tomorrow. I'm talking about today. It's already there. It's already happening in all organizations. It's just that the global economy is already operating on an ecosystem level, kind of with all the interdependencies that we experience. It's just our thinking hasn't caught up with that level of complexity. And how to really open up our thinking, particularly our economic thinking, to the complexity and the interdependency that we are already dealing with in the real world, that's really what I try to contribute to. And I came from Europe here to the United States some 19 years ago. And back then, I was already concerned about some of these questions. But I realized I had just written, my my PhD thesis on something like reflexive modernization of capitalism as revolution from within. No one understood that. But and I realized that, you know, I could talk about all these things, but what was the value I created for others actually doing this kind of work? Zip, nothing. So I came here to the United States to learn to be more useful as a researcher. And I joined back then the MIT Learning Center around kind of Peter Senge, Ed Schein, kind of other people who in a very applied way brought together innovative thinkers and practitioners, and you know, in that case, mostly companies, in order to learn together and learn by doing how to create learning infrastructures for organizations and kind of larger systems. So that's really what brought me here. And when I look back and ask myself, what is it that I really learned kind of in these 19 years about organizational learning and about kind of how learning and development really works in social systems, one key insight that I came away with is that there are two sources of learning. One is which are embodied in our current learning processes, organizationally in larger systems. One is basically learning by reflecting on the past, learning by reflecting on the experiences of the past. And that's kind of the so-called experiential learning model. And when you look at all the best practices from consulting companies, from kind of all the great in academia kind of approaches, methodologies, and organizational learning, they're all based on the same learning model, which is that one. Yet, if you go out, work with NGOs, communities, companies, governments, the last 10, 15 years, what have we seen? We have seen like people dealing with disruptive changes where sometimes the past is not very helpful. And sometimes the past is the very obstacle to come up with a better way of framing or kind of approaching the situation. So seeing that, made me realize that there is a second source of learning, which is not learning by reflecting on the past, but learning by connecting, learning from the future as it emerges in the now. So learning from kind of connecting with an emerging future possibility, and then, so sensing that, and then making that happen. And when I studied 150 thought leaders and innovators in science, business, and society, I realized kind of the way many of these people work is not at all what we talk about in academia with the experiential learning cycle. So the essence of all, and of course we know it from social entrepreneurship, we know it from the creative process, the essence of that is a different kind of process that brings us kind of beyond this compartment of our intelligence and requires us to connect with a deeper capacity of knowing, right? That kind of resides more here, and that is more kind of out there, kind of connected with our senses. And that can be described as sensing and actualizing an emerging future possibility, or sensing and actualizing my highest future possibility. So I saw these phenomena, and how to do that really became a guiding focus. How to do that as an individual and also collectively became a guiding focus for my own work. And this is kind of what I just said, it's like concept. But where did I really experience that myself a little bit the first time? I remember I grew up near Hamburg. My parents actually are among the pioneers of biodynamic farming in Germany. So 55 years ago, they switched. And so that's, of course, when you really track my own thinking, that's where I got like 90% of my inspiration from. Right, seeing that kind of feel, and what I saw my parents doing with the land, the field, right, the field of the farmer, I basically try to do, right, stumbling kind of try to do on the social field? Kind of what are these cultivating the less visible conditions, kind of, you know, how of relationships, kind of collaboration? Now, so at the age, that was in the late 1970s, I was at the age of 16, I think, and we lived in this old kind of 250-year-old farmhouse and so on. Every morning, my siblings and I would go to Hamburg to school by train. And the last, on that day, kind of the first odd thing that happened was that I was called out by the principal during the last hour, and she told me to take my bag and go home for no obvious reason. But I noticed her eyes were red as if she had cried just prior to talking to me. So that was a little odd. Took my bag, went to the train station, called home. There was no ring, no nothing. Boarded the train, and then, you know, after an hour, kind of at the destination, no one to pick me up, no bus. So the first time in my life, I took a taxi. And for the last 8 kilometers, going to the farm, and half home, I saw it. I saw that there was smoke. The sky was black, and the smoke arose from the place where the farm used to be. The last kilometer, kind of the driveway was blocked, hundreds of people and firefighters and so on. I remember kind of running past these people and coming to stop right in front of the fireplace. And my senses, what I saw was a gigantic burning heap of rubble. And as that, I couldn't believe that kind of the world that I had been living in up to that moment, you know, no longer existed. Kind of everything was left was this gigantic burning heap of rubble. And as that picture slowly started to penetrate my mind, I realized that it felt as if someone pulls away. I realized how much I thought who I am was actually connected to that. Only then I realized it, when it was no longer there. So it felt like someone pulling away the ground under your feet, so you drop into really a space of nothingness. Kind of there, a little moment of nothingness. And then I realized, well, there's still somebody left. There's still someone watching all this and taking that in. And then something happened that I never, by surprise, that I didn't experience before, which is suddenly I felt like a little bit like elevated, kind of above my, elevated upwards, and felt a clarity of attention and a clarity of awareness that I have never experienced before, and felt drawn to a direction that wasn't my old self, that wasn't the stuff that just went up in flames, but it was connected to a future possibility that I could bring into reality. Could, maybe. It's a faint possibility. So it's not like a very tangible part of yourself, but it's a field of possibility, somehow connected. So I felt that. I felt the energy of that. And it was like a clarity. It was, and I was taken totally by surprise, because I had no idea that kind of there is, you know, there's kind of the tangible self, and then there's this space of possibility that I didn't connect to before. So the next morning, my grandfather, who was 87, came back to what should be his last visit on the farm. He was in the final week of his life. Somebody drove him by, he exited the car and went straight up to my father, who was doing the cleanup work. And as you probably know, kind of from big fires, kind of it takes a couple of days to kill them, so there was still kind of a lot of burning stuff going on. So he didn't even turn his head to the place that was no longer there, and he spent much of his life developing. He went straight up to my father, took his hand, and said, head up, my boy, look forward. And then they exchanged a few more words, and then he turned around and left. And this attitude, kind of, you're in the final week of your life. You are, just something happened, and a lot of, you know, what you really cared about went out of the window. And your attention is not focusing on the loss, but it's focusing on kind of that field, that emerging possibility that through this event becomes visible at the horizon. That's an attitude that had a deep, really, impact on me, and that really inspired me to kind of to ask this question, kind of, okay, kind of learning from the past, but isn't there something else? I mean, isn't there, in reality, when something new happens, kind of something else? And applying that, kind of, and I feel like today we live in a moment kind of where this attitude that I watched as a 16-year-old, kind of my grandfather doing, this is this attitude kind of to not be distracted by, you know, the noise, kind of the loss, but really focusing on what's wanting to emerge. That's the attitude that over the next decade or two will be more necessary than ever and will be really kind of the foundation for us to bring this economic transformation that we all are working on in different ways into reality. So when I, Susan, when I, ask you, so okay, what is it really you want to put into the center of this day? You mentioned kind of America Awakening. And I thought, America Awakening, so that's, what does that really mean? It means, to me anyhow, kind of, it is, America Awakening means, so what is kind of the part going away? And maybe it also means kind of a deepening of the American dream. And when I look kind of at the picture of what is emerging, so what is kind of, what is dying and ending and what is wanting to emerge, I would say when I am, you know, and when I try to boil down, okay, in terms of our society, in terms of the dream, the American dream that has inspired many here and many around the world, what are the key components of that? And what is the crisis? What is the civilization crisis we really encounter today? And I would say three things. So first, kind of what is, and I'm not really an expert on that, but you know, the first thing, and when I think about the American dream, is pursuit of happiness. So it is doing your own thing. It's also really what brought me here, because I could do things here that I couldn't do in Europe. It's just the experience of many Europeans, I guess. I know, at least. So that's the first piece. Then another element, there is like, so that's like a cultural element, I would say. Then there's a second element, I write here a D for democracy. Kind of, there's a deep aspiration, and democratic aspiration that, you know, was born here, went around the world, and it's still kind of a defining piece of that dream. And then the last one is a G, and that's kind of the economic dimension now, growth. So the myth here really is that, you know, was shared and has been shared by the mainstream is kind of that the growth goes on forever. So what is it? So that's kind of the dream, the economic, political, the cultural. What's the reality? What is the crisis today about? Well, on the growth one, 1.5, so we are using 1.5 planets. And another way of kind of the, you know, what we are generating here, the shadow that we generate, has to do with, let me just write, TBTF, too big to fail, right? So I don't need to explain. So that's like two, right, roadblocks, kind of that's where we are hitting the wall. Then democracy. Right, so I only write three letters again, or in this case, Washington, D.C., WDC, as the embodiment of collective paralysis. We see it all over the world. It's just particularly visible there. Like, collectively, we are unable to address the real challenges that we face as a community. So it's like collective paralysis. That's our crisis here in the democratic political system. And then, on the happiness, well, what's the problem here? Well, more GDP does not translate into more well-being. We all know these studies, that it has been shown many times in developed countries, right? In developed countries, more GDP does not translate into more well-being. So how can we summarize this with four letters again? ADHD, right? Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, not only as a cultural condition, but also as a cultural crisis that happens in our classrooms. So we create classrooms that makes a big part of our populations, you know, move. But they have to sit. So we create a norm that doesn't work for many of our kids. And then we diagnose them and we, you know, medicate them. So it tells as much about kind of our own educational crisis here as about anything else. So that's the crisis. Now, what is emerging, basically? So it's the crisis, I'm basically saying, so it's like the same thing in our economic system, in our political system, in our economic system. So where's the new happening? And it, as we know, it's happening all around us. So where's that, and what is that? And the way I would describe that is this. It's flipping the pyramid. And where do we see that? Let me start with education, flipping the classroom. It's like from the place I am working, which is MIT, it's an amazing revolution going on. You know, we used to have like 9,000 students in Cambridge. Now, really with the edX revolution, with the online revolution, it's a massive, basically all leading universities put up everything for free for everyone, including certificates. So it's a massive, so now it's no longer 9,000 to, you know, elite students, it's like potentially 7 billion users. It's a massive increase, democratization of really education opportunities. It's an amazing opportunity, and so it's with the flipped classroom, also a possibility to kind of bring lots of these lectures outside and then create the classroom in a much more co-creative space. But, of course, it also has the possibility that it's just getting everything worse. So that kind of the quality, the deep learning spaces are disappearing. And yet, it has the possibility of doing that. So that's kind of the flipped classroom, kind of as an amazing possibility to, for example, with the MOOCs. So for example, just last week, I got the green light to create a MOOC on the economic transformation that we are in, kind of the economic transformation from ego to eco, and to create like a deep learning environment around us that basically, so we can use education as global grassroots mobilization, kind of where we have a global learning community on economic transformation, creating kind of local communities that co-create kind of the current economic transformation and societal transformation that's necessary, and really use that as a backbone of making that happen. So amazing possibilities that are opening up here and that can really redefine the playing field. I'm skipping over the democracy because that's not the main topic today, but just to say that, what does that mean? It means to reinvent these old forms of democracy through new forms that are more direct, more distributed, and more dialogic. So it's kind of these three Ds that need to really, and you know, I think we all know examples of that, but you know, it needs focus and it's as underattended probably as the economic transformation. I want to now spend a few minutes on, you know, what does this kind of flipping the pyramid and creating kind of this focusing on this emerging space, not the one that's kind of going away, but what's wanting to emerge here. I want to say a few things about how does that play out in the third space in society, which is the economic space, which of course today is the most important one. We could say it's really all about the economy today, and kind of these other, the cultural and the educational and the political, they are like side effects, right? They are like the side dishes to the main course, and the main course is the economy. So what then, how do we think, so what then is the, are the big changes that are going on in terms of the economic transformation? And I want to just introduce something very simple here, just as a framework, which is, you know, what is the really the production function? Kind of when we think about the economy, one way of thinking about it is in terms of the production function, which is kind of nature, labor, capital, then of course, you know, those are the old classic ones. Then we have, of course, technology and management, when we look at really how, you know, we put the production function together today in the economy. And then, of course, we have the consumption side. And then it's the question, okay, we have all this division of labor from local to global. How do we stitch it all together? How do we bring all these pieces together? So that's kind of coordination. And as part of that, you know, maybe the institution of coordination, we could also say there's like an ownership piece here. Okay, if those are like key categories, kind of key, so when we think about the economy, then I believe the root crisis of the economic transformation today is that we think about, in theory, and we create institutions around all these seven or eight factors that I just mentioned, based on the old thinking, which is ego system awareness based. And what's necessary is to reframe each of these key categories of economic thought and action in terms of ecosystem awareness. And that's actually what's going on. So I'm not talking about the day after tomorrow. I'm talking about what it is that we are currently already doing. So very quickly, kind of nature, kind of we reframe nature from a commodity to something that is a place-based ecosystem that we need to steward. So it's no longer a commodity that we... So we reframe and reinvent labor, again, from a regulated commodity to something that really is about the human right and access to entrepreneurial opportunity. We reframe our capital from purely financial and number-driven capital to an intentional capital, so where capital is money is being used with an intention that, you know, is connected to the well-being of the whole. We reframe technology from system-centric and only serving elites to something that is more eco- and human-centric, and that probably Jeremy Rifkin has described in his Third Industrial Revolution. We reframe management and leadership from something that is like heroic individuals at the top of kind of hierarchies to something that is more collective, more distributed, and where leadership really is thought of from a systems point of view as the capacity of a system to sense and shape the future. If you don't like the word systems, just take community. The leadership is the capacity of a community to sense and shape the future. So that's what's happening here in the leadership space. Consumption. Well, I think Juliet was here like a year or two ago, right, speaking to you. Kind of, it's kind of basically reframing consumerism. More and bigger is better to collaborative, conscious consumption. And kind of that's another area kind of many of us, many of you are involved in. And then coordination. So what do we see there? Basically, there are like three coordination mechanisms in the economy today. It's hierarchy, competition in markets, and the third one is negotiations among stakeholders, right? Organized interest groups dealing with each other. And the fourth one that I believe is missing is awareness-based collective action. So what we need is kind of pre-market areas of collaboration, kind of where we, you know, create kind of new areas of co-creative collaboration, and where we bring together not the abstract interest negotiating with each other, but we bring together the key stakeholders of a system, be that educational or be that health system or other systems, and allow them to create a shared understanding kind of the system, and then to innovate at the scale of the whole system from an awareness of that whole. So awareness-based collective action. Where do we see that today? Two areas, I would say, most visible. One is crisis response, because all the other thing is broken down. Now we really need to pay attention, and everything is coming together spontaneous, connecting and coordinating by looking at the real situation rather than, you know, other mechanisms. And second, local living economy, right? You mentioned it before. Why is the future showing up first locally and not in the other areas? Because in the local, all kind of ecosystem problems are essentially commons problems, right? So the commons locally are right in your face. You see it. You cannot, you know, it's very difficult to be in denial of it. The global commons, right? I don't see, I don't smell, kind of I can be ignorant of. So that's why these kind of new ecosystem ways of organizing show up first locally, which is why that is an important leverage point. And then, so that's coordination. The last one, ownership. Yes, we need, of course, new ownership forms. We need to advance the success stories of private ownership, kind of as the second class next to state ownership, and create a third type of ownership forms, which is commons-based ownership, as Peter Barnes suggested in his Capitalism 3.0, and that's, of course, another kind of key, which basically is bringing in, not the quarterly perspective, like in the private sector, or the four-year perspective, like in state-owned forms of estate-type forms of ownership, but a generational perspective, as Peter Barnes suggested, kind of with where the stakeholders of the next generation really come into the conversation in terms, and that would be like an ownership form that would apply basically to the commons challenges and opportunities that we need to organize around. All right. So many of you, are working already on many of them, and what I'm noticing is, so all these things, so I'm not saying anything new here. I'm just naming what's already going on, and all I'm saying is, hey, this is all belonging to the same picture. Often, like, kind of, okay, so, I mean, you talk to the, I mean, so some people think it's all about money, right? If we only have like, and then others, it's all about whatever, whatever. I mean, you know our groups. So it's, so what has happening, and what I also love about this gathering is that we are widening. We need to broadening and deepening this discourse and really bring the change makers across these systems together. So for example, focusing on the GDP, kind of a new, how do we really measure new forms of, how can we create and measure new forms of economic progress beyond GDP? We know GDP isn't useful for us, but what are the alternatives? So we created a global well-being lab, the global well-being lab basically is a very simple infrastructure that begins to connect to some of the innovators across this whole kind of equation here. And the way we supported them is that, so you mentioned Michelle, kind of, she was one of them. We had like the governor of one of the, of Oregon, kind of one of the states here, and NGO people and community people. So from different places, both global north, global south. And then we went for 1 week to Brazil, kind of, looking there at interesting examples. And the other one, the other week we went to Bhutan, kind of looking at GNH, gross national happiness, how it's being implemented, and how kind of alternative indicators of economic progress really can redirect both the policy making and also the economic progress. And then, so that was like deep dive into two interesting areas. And then we basically said, okay, now you're all kind of very sophisticated change makers. No, go out, do your own thing. Kind of take the best ideas that you encountered or co-created as a result of that. And now let's move into multi-local prototyping. Everyone in their own institutional context is driving some innovation based on what we saw. And for example, a year ago, or a little bit more than a year ago, there were like 5 states in the US working on GPI, Genuine Progress Indicator. Today it's 20. So that was, and we, some of the key drivers of that initiative have been part of that lab. Then there's a whole bunch of other initiatives that came out of this prototyping. And it's just, I'm just giving that as an example that all these possibilities are already there. It doesn't need that much to really connect the dots and to generate innovation initiatives that begin to link kind of all these institutional innovations here in a more coherent way. I want to end with the question. So let me stop here and say, okay, what did I say? I said we are living in a moment of disruption. There is like something that's dying here. We see we are encountering. So all these problems here is really seeing the shadow of our old version, our old dream, you could say, our old civilizational idea. And what we need to do is we need to deepen the dream. Kind of we need to flip the classroom, and not only the classroom. We need to also regenerate kind of the political and the economic system. We shared a little bit about that. And a lot of that is already happening. But what I'm also noticing is that, you know, in all these fields, and you will know that you probably have made a similar observation. We have all these great prototypes and examples. And then when really do they go to scale? And do they really transform the system? Or is it just kind of small stuff that makes us feel good? And then, you know, just the mainstream, even more powerful kind of moving. So are we just kidding ourselves? Or how can we? And so I have been through my life, I'm daily really asking myself, where is it that I can really be most of benefit? So I got like access through kind of being in a place like MIT gives, you know, I thought, well, what can I do useful? So 7 years ago, I started an initiative, which is tri-sector innovation, bringing together, realizing kind of we are moving into a period of disruption. But no one is preparing the institutional leaders. Yes, we need social entrepreneurship, but we also need to help the next generation in these old institutions to connect with each other, to connect with grassroots initiatives, and to really create the foundations to bring some of these innovations to the scale that's necessary today. So what can we do? Emerging next generation of leaders. So I went around and asked companies, governments and NGOs, can you give us some of your best people and kind of we just go on a journey together, try to find out kind of how this, how we can innovate together tri-sector, kind of by building platforms of collaboration tri-sector. Almost everyone said yes. There was one exception. That was a big surprise. Then it took forever. I mean, it's the first time we did that. It took like a year. Everyone stood in their job, but it was like, you know, a week here, 3 days there sort of thing. And let me just cut a long story short. In the end, high-level personal transformation, high-level relational transformation, although they, you know, some of these institutions had been fighting with each other before, then they did prototypes. And at the end, I thought, well, yeah, that's interesting. Like some of them were really good, and some of them, well, they tried. And so that was the end of that in 2007. Today, 5 years on, totally different picture. So what I initially thought was a mixed thing now has a huge impact. I mean, it created kind of these groups, created initiatives that founded new companies, micro-venture networks, platforms of collaboration, changing policies, the way policy is being done in Indonesia is now moving, these platforms are now moving into other countries. One of them is China, working with the Chinese government. This year they sent us the ICBC, which is the biggest state-owned enterprise in the world. It's also the biggest bank in the world. And as you may have seen, the Fortune 2000 list for the first time was topped by a Chinese company. It's that company. So it's also the biggest company in the world. So there, some of their executive team members and their high potential leaders came and they said, okay, now help us innovate, reinvent the financial sector. So that's now underway. But one exercise, and kind of it's a little microcosm story that I think is indicative. So we put them through a climate change simulation lab. So it's a half day. They enter the room. They have a briefing before. They enter the room, six tables. United States, EU, other developed countries, India, China, other developing countries. They had got briefings before, so they each represent kind of their. And then the facilitator is Secretary General of the United Nations, and updating them on the current climate change situation, right? Basically, it's all fact-based, and then they need to decide and negotiate with each other emissions cuts, right? So when do you stop the increase of your emissions? When are you starting to cut down and at what rate? So these are the three things. Then these decisions are being inputted into a model, a kind of a science-based model of kind of where all the climate change simulations, which is also being used for training kind of the real negotiators. And then the result is feedback to the group, and then they go into the second. I have seen this thing many times, and it always, I mean, it's like dire, right? It ends in a catastrophe, and people are puzzled and angry. Kind of you see denial, depression, cynicism, all of that comes up. This time, it was different. So the facilitator took more, the Secretary General, before they did their second round, he gave them more like the option to really think about that. He visualized what happens. Kind of when you decide that, here's what happens, and so on. There was more like an educate to seeing the outcomes of your own actions. And they didn't have a full breakthrough, but they almost did. And so I just thought, and when I went home for that, that's just a few weeks ago, I thought, well, what just happened? Why was it so different than the other ones, groups that I had seen? And there are like five, what allowed them to shift? Because as long as they just represent their country interest, it's just going to hell. We know that. It's exactly what happens in Copenhagen and all these other. So we are not nearly even addressing the situation, kind of the seriousness of the situation. So why? What allowed them to shift? And here are the five conditions that I saw. One, you need to create the place, right? I mean, that's kind of, they walked into that room, kind of somebody needs to create the container, bring the right players together. That's the first thing. Secondly, science and data, right? Kind of there is no, everything is science and database. I mean, there is no kind of escape from that. And kind of that was kind of the visualization of really the kind of the current situation that all peer-based science and so on. That was the second element that when you talk to them later on, kind of that really made them act differently. Number three, there is like an aesthetic dimension. It's the feeling dimension. It's not, okay, 2, 3, and then a typhoon, 4, 5 meters sea level rise. No. You then go to, what do you want to see? You go to that website and say, okay, what happens to Shanghai? No longer there. What happens to Hangzhou? Half gone. So it's then when you begin. So there's like a feeling dimension. And it's kind of, I'm just giving that one example. There were others. So the aesthetic. So activism, civic and also social entrepreneurship is activated when something connects here. So that was the third dimension. The fourth one is, the fourth condition is making the system see itself. And so it's like they make decisions, blah, 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 and then kind of you put that in and you project that, and then you feed that back. It's closing the feedback loop between what we do and what happens to us. Look at what we are doing to ourselves. So that's kind of, and the fifth one is connected to that. It's a facilitator who basically holds the space. So he was like, so it's holding up these charts and images and letting it sink in. So it's like me standing in front of the fire, kind of, first, you don't believe what's out there. It needs a moment. It slowly, it penetrates your mind and it's sinking in. Exactly the same thing happens there. So we live in an ecosystem world, but our ecosystem awareness is how we think. You need to hold the space for that reality to sink in, to penetrate the mind. You can almost watch it, really. And then, so you need to hold that space. And then the group begins to act differently. Now, I'm giving this example because I have seen the same thing many times in other situations as well. And I think that's what we are missing globally. So if we want to transform, if we really want to live up, just go beyond kind of these, the small successes that we have had so far, we really need to bring in these conditions, to the places where it matters. And personally, on that note, personally, what I'm really saying here is we not only thinking about the new economy is really, for me, it's what does it take to really shift our focus here and to cultivate this rather than being distracted by all the noise up here? What does it take? And I think it takes two things. One is a set of institutional innovations around these eight acupuncture points that I mentioned, right? Nature, labor, capital, all these things that I mentioned. So that's, of course, one. It's institutional innovation. But the other one, the thing that we need is a new collective leadership capacity, which is basically, people, a new generation of people who can do what this facilitator did in the story I just shared. Right, the five things. People who can put these five things into place in every city, kind of in every system, kind of in all the places, be that a classroom, be that all the places that need to flip. How do we build? So we need that capacity. In other words, if we only have institutional innovation, right, we know that. We bring all the right stakeholders together into the same room, what happens? Nothing good. It's the same speeches, right? Unless kind of we bring in a new social technology that allows us to move from debate to co-creating something. So that's kind of the mindset shift. We need a social technology. I forgot what I said. We need a social technology that allows you to go through the shift of in stakeholder situations from a debate style, same old speeches, to move to another way of dialoguing and co-creating with each other. To put that capacity there, that's the other condition. So we need the institutional innovation and we need this new leadership capacity. And what we are missing is a place that's really building this on a level of scale that's necessary now. And there are many ways how we can frame that, but that's where I feel there are so many young people really looking for that now, and we failed as a generation to put this damn infrastructure into place. We have all the elements, but they are not connected. We have the living examples, we have the methods and tools, we have kind of great, inspiring change leaders in many different, but we don't have the platform that links all of that together and creates a landing place for the next generation to learn this stuff and make it happen at the scale necessary now. My name, so I don't know what to call it. I would call it, it's a new type of multi-local global leadership school that is focusing on the economic and societal transformation that's underway now that we describe here and that we will discuss more this afternoon, and that cultivates, that kind of brings in kind of three pieces. One is research, right? Really, what are we really learning? What's working, what's not? Kind of how does these, so these kind of transformations and going to scale, so what is it that we are really learning and making that research available to all change makers? Two, creating kind of these helpful environments on a systems level, these five conditions or whatever the number is, but it's basically, for example, the global well-being lab, kind of bringing these change makers together across, you know, systems and put them here, put them there, and then those are small things, but we don't, so where we really begin to innovate on a larger scale, kind of, and leverage the linkages. So it's kind of being in support of these innovation labs and kind of creating these conditions at the levels and the places that are necessary now. And the last one is building the leadership capacity. And this kind of leadership capacity to making that available, really, at the end of the day, really, for every city, every place. But I think the way to start that, you start with a few places that are connected with each other and that work from the same intention. And these places largely exist already in China, in Indonesia, in Brazil, kind of here. We know it's kind of, the networks are already there. We are not putting it together. We are not really, you know, serious enough to some degree to connecting with the current challenges that we face at the level of intention, at the level of scale that's necessary today. So that's what my inspiration, also my frustration, kind of in terms of, hey, how long do you want to talk about that before you do something? It's like small, small, small here and, you know, all these prototypes, but when is it really that we put all of that together? Thank you. Nature, labor, capital, technology, leadership, and then consumption. It's the collaborative, conscious consumption, coordination, and ownership.
Where are you seeing the greatest innovation in large organizations? I know you've worked with Tritos Bank. I know you've worked with, I think, with Seventh Generation, with BALLE. What about the more traditional organizations? Where's the transformation taking place there?
Well, I mean, many of us probably think, well, where does the new come from? From the periphery. So that's why overly focusing on the big organizations probably is a waste of energy, because the new starts outside usually, right? And then, but I feel there's also like then you need to bring it back in. So there's, where do I see interesting organizations at a larger scale, kind of that, embody some of these principles? Well, one at a really larger scale, I would say, is Natura, which is a Brazil-based international company working with 5 or 6 million consultants, which is, you know, micro-entrepreneurs really at the base of the socio-economic pyramid that create their own ventures. And that they cultivate a relationship with, they also, so they kind of, on the social divide, the ecological divide, they really try to, it's not everything ideal really, but they really try to do good things. They see there is a DNA in the company that tries to see itself as part of a social mission, as a part of creating a better society. There's an element of that. That doesn't mean that everyone is happy in that organization and everyone, but so you could see real progress there. I think that's one example. Another example, I worked a little bit with Alibaba, which is in China, the a huge, I think it's the biggest online company in the world or something like that. And founded by a very, I think he was teacher. It's a very inspirational figure who is, you know, operates from a social mission himself. And it's creating like a whole ecosystem of companies. What I thought, so they use the ecosystem term, right? And they have like independent enterprises. And then they cultivate this whole thing because there's so much interdependency. And very young people and very dynamic and open. What they basically do is they create infrastructures that make their users turn them into entrepreneurs, kind of help them to create their own businesses. So I thought that was an interesting, both organizationally in terms of aspiration and huge scale. They will, people say they will have an IPO soon. They could soon be the biggest company in the world, some people say, but they have a massive, what we have with Amazon and eBay and some stuff we don't have, it's all combined there in this. PayPal is also so in this, so that's an interesting, you know, and it's an entire, you know, it's entirely young people driven and led. So it's, anyway, but so I don't think big organizations are the solutions. What I'm trying to advocate is we need new platforms of collaboration, because what I experience in my life is you work with these big institutions and particularly with the younger leaders, and then if you really look into their, I almost said soul, kind of really talk with them deeply, right? What do you recognize? They're the same. They're the same. The same aspirations, the same, like sometimes some different choices, yes. But the deeper aspiration ground is the same. There's the same aspiration. It's not just real, it's not realized because they're in this little prison there sometimes, or it feels like that. There's an aspiration to link to this new economy movement, to kind of creating a society or economic conditions that create well-being for all. I see it in my class at MIT, right? So that it used to be like 10 years ago, a few people interested in socioeconomic change, everyone else heading to Wall Street. Now it's the other way around. And so you ask, so half of the group is mid-career executives. You ask them, okay, why are you here? It's like they are like high potentials from their global companies, come to here to MIT. You ask them, so why are you here? And they say, the higher I get in my organization, they are all already pretty high, the less inspired I am by what my company is asking me to do. That's their experience. So that's really, so I'm not, I don't think big systems is the solution or small is the solution. We need these platforms. We need these new platforms where we can link and learn and innovate. Innovate at the scale which is not only the small pockets, but innovate at the scale of the whole.
Hi. First of all, thank you very much. Very inspiring, very informative. Question, it seems implicit, certainly throughout the discussion, there are certain concepts that I kind of was sort of are there. For instance, equity, justice, morality, ethics. But is there sort of a more explicit sort of description or at least expression of where those fit into the sort of the new economic scheme?
Yeah. No, I think it's a point well taken. And I think it needs to be spelled out, kind of. It is part of that. And it's also, I find it interesting. So I almost make that as an experiment. When I, like, for example, do a sustainability class, kind of, or started to launch into that work, I personally try to be low on ethics. Because I don't want to put people into the next straitjacket. And my experience is, you create the right kind of learning environment. You put people in front, you make people see what's going on. And what happens is, kind of that this deeper ethical ground of action is accessible to all of us. So I try to, my focus is really I believe that the access point is not more ethics classes and more this and that. That's overrated, frankly. And it's just, you know, an add-on to a meal that's already going in the wrong direction. What we need to change is that so what's missing is seeing reality. Seeing is the access point where consciousness can be opened up. I have been always inspired by the German poet and, you know, thinker, I guess, Goethe, who once said that who thought that his main contribution is a different kind of science. It's not all the poetry things. And the essence of his approach is captured in the following sentence. Every object well contemplated opens up a new organ of perception within us. That's what I believe. Why? Because I have seen it. And what I told you, that's what was exactly the reason why I told you the story with the Chinese group kind of in this climate change thing. Because it is the seeing of reality. If you really, but it's like it's a phenomenological process. You need to really allow that to penetrate your mind. That opens up. So it's the listening. The most important skill that I do in all these classes is the same thing, it's listening, right? Take an empathy walk with a person totally different to you. That's my first class assignment, for example. Yeah, totally, right? Socially, politically, kind of whatever, kind of maximum different, and be a guest in that person's life. So it's like, I think, kind of, we all do sense-making in society. There's no lack of sense-making. What's the problem? It's silo-based sense-making. Right? We don't have the co-sensing, the cross kind of, we don't do the sense-making together with the other stakeholders that if we are connected with and kind of really allow the seeing and sensing to go deeper, then creates kind of not only kind of new ideas, but also really a new, I agree, kind of a new ethical or moral foundation. But my attempt is to not preach about what I believe that is, but to basically get rid of the rubble that's in between, the noise, because it's already there for everyone, but it's just not accessible because there's too much noise, my view.
Thank you very much for that. When I first read the story of the farmhouse burning, it was really striking, and I wonder, this all sounds very existential to me, and I guess how do we voluntarily lose everything, and maybe you addressed that kind of in those five stages, maybe helping people to lose everything to get that feeling, but the existential piece of it just feels really important to me.
I agree, and so here's my experience, kind of that, I am just amazed how open and ready people are to move into that. You know, in all sorts of conventional, but also more innovative organizations or communities. And I'm amazed by the lack of pushback, really. You get in creating kind of these deeper learning and listening and mindfulness-based environments. And it's, so seeing the lack of pushback makes me wonder, well, probably we are not courageous enough. We are just under. Because we all have had once, you know, a negative experience, but guess what? It's 10, 20 years ago. That's another age. You know, the field has shifted. Kind of people, so there is a new space of possibility now available that we are under-leveraging because we operate based on experiences we had like back then, but these conditions are no longer existing. That's a little bit my sense.
Several years ago, there was a book written it was a novel. The title of it was "Only the Rich Can Save Us," and I think it was a Ralph Nader novel. And I must say that I didn't read it, but I've also been noticing research lately that says that rich people, particularly people that are newly rich, have a very difficult time connecting, empathizing with others. What you're really talking about here is this massive need for connection. And we all seem to kind of live, at least I know I do, and I have for most of my life, lived out of this conversation of survival of the fittest, you know, that that we have to fight to survive. So where are the new ideas to transcend that belief that life is a dog-eat-dog struggle?
Yeah, that is a great question, and I think it points at there's a lot of evidence, not only kind of that, you know, this struggle for life story or narrative is something very single-sided and also be less and less effective, but that there is another narrative about evolution, about the economy, about kind of what makes us effective, that you know, has a lot more scientific but also personal and in part institutional support. But we are not bringing out that other narrative with a coherence, kind of with a cultivation that is really intentional and is making that available to the degree necessary now, which is exactly why I suggested that what I believe the leverage point is that we need to focus on is kind of this global transformation leadership action school that really would put that type of curriculum into the center, kind of creates communities around that, and then kind of really makes it available to all. Because yes, all these stories and narratives are there, but they are not somehow as, they're certainly not mainstream, and they're also not available to many. And so that's where we need a more intentional effort, I think.
My name is Tembi, and I'm originally from Malawi. And Malawi is like a country in Southern Africa. And as you were talking about the necessity to create platforms that encourage more collaboration, I was just thinking to myself that I listened the past 50 years, one of the, I guess, approach a lot of the development direction Africa has taken is like making a case for more collaboration, and institutions like the African Development Bank, SADC in Southern Africa specifically, ECOWAS in West Africa, like lots of institutions have emerged. But again, as you're doing a presentation, I was asking myself that have this institution been innovated enough? Probably not, and you're definitely right that there's a need for a shift, especially on the conceptualization of development. And then I was thinking that most of the development approach, I guess, Africa has taken has been greatly influenced by, you know, the World Bank, the IMF, that they're the leaders, they're the one perceived, you know, to know how things need to be done. And then clearly you say that there's a crisis, there are lots of problems, there's a shift that needs to happen. How do we create this, accelerate this shift, like change in terms of conceptions at the institutional level, specifically for the big LS development institution? And for leaders in Africa specifically as well, what are the best ways to kind of, I guess, create incentives that promote this kind of shift in perception on how leadership has to be done? So I know lots of questions, but thank you. But those were the thoughts that I had from your presentation.
Well, I mean, I have maybe some of that we can also discuss over lunch, or I have been actually with that question in mind doing in the last few years a three-year project, or participating in that in Namibia, kind of working on maternal health, kind of helping the government and all other health sector players to make an impact and to collaborate in a different way that is strengthening kind of the well-being and the health of mothers and their newborns. And so what's the learning there? Well, one is it takes time. Two, you need to bring partner in that, and that's why it's almost never happening, who understand this, right? Because everyone, so how is development done? Well, you have a project here, project here, project here, and then it's all silo solutions. That actually is worsening the system's condition overall. So how do you, but we don't have like this kind of, how can we strengthen the system and kind of really the capacity of the leaders in these institutions to realize their aspirations. And that, and what we also learned there. So it's one, you need to bring in kind of, it's like almost orthogonal to that. So it's like, you know, it's not this silo, it's kind of another dimension that many people say, well, what is that? This container, I mean, this, you know, the five things that I mentioned, that is nothing. I mean, that's like, but it is, so you need to create that. It takes time. And then, interestingly there, they thought there's like a big plan behind, right? They thought that someone, you know, has figured that out. So there's also like a history of not being in control, a history of being basically screwed by the system so often, so deep, that we, I think one of the success factors was really to trash all plans, kind of to trash and to really start from scratch. And to really create this playing field where it's not like all these donor-driven nonsense that's, you know, just worsening the problem. So that was another thing that I saw, and kind of we were lucky that we could do it because we had a lot of flexibility in that situation that allowed us to basically scratch it and say, hey, there's nothing behind. We can, so it's about you to define what the changes you want to make happen together. And then the last one I learned in that is so that actually if you take people out, you know, out of their institutional, very narrow, constrained environments, and move them around, have them walk in the shoes of people without access to health, kind of in the remote areas and so on, it's very organically. I mean, it's not like a painful process of, you know, near death. No, it's like kind of the opening up to reality is a very organic process that kind of connects you. And if you do that with diverse groups, it's very natural then to think about the bigger picture and to let that go. And yes, there is, and that maybe, you know, is a last reflection on that particular project. You need, in order to connect to the emerging future, right, you need confidence. You need to believe that the universe is a helpful place and not your enemy. So that's really a belief, right? And if you think it's an enemy out there, you're closing down. But what this process that I'm talking about is, it's a process of opening up the mind, the heart, and the will. But you can only open up if you have that belief, so that kind of you're comfortable with stepping into that unknown. Given the history, kind of given the terrible history that, you know, my country, in that case, Germany, left in Namibia, and you know, others, there's a lot of damage that was done. So you need more time. You need to really be, to hold the space for that, for this confidence, develop, to show up at a level of strength that allows you to deal with the opportunities that life is giving to you. Just some thoughts.
I see these paradigms as these new paradigms as good in theory, and possibly in practice in places like New York City and the Northeast, where there are already relatively localized economies. But how do you see taking on monopolistic structures like Walmart or Monsanto?
Monsanto, for example, right? So how would you take on that? Well, it's, you know, transparency, dialogue. I think, you know, in that case, it's like public opinion. It's like, so how does a system like Monsanto work? Basically, exclusion, right? So you, you know, organize interest groups, backdoor deals, you know, revolving door between all these things that we know. And then, you know, you come up with deals at the cost of those not at the table, right? The farmers, the nature, the future generations, and so forth. Yeah, we need to create transparency around that and a public conversation that brings the main focus on the main issue. And what is the main issue? It's kind of the well-being of the whole, kind of it's the well-being of the entire community. And the reason, the problems we have in that whole sector, the monopolies and the power there is basically the exclusion and the manipulation of public perception. I mean, the exclusion of stakeholders and the spin on communication and the lack of a real public discourse that is based on dialogues and facts. Dialogue and facts. That's what we need to develop. I think that's, and then once that is there, I'm sure. I mean, I'm not working with Monsanto, and I don't think I could, I could come back home if I did that. But you know, in principle, I don't. I mean, if the intention is to transform what they do now, I wouldn't have an issue. But I don't see that intention, so there's no point. At this point, I think what's necessary there is to shift, to create transparency, right? Bring what's going on into really the public conversation. Many of the initiatives that are already underway, kind of, including the labeling and so forth. But then, I left out the dialogue space, right? Kind of this. So I was just. But once that is there, kind of, and a lot of the new democracy forms is actually kind of having a better quality of public discourse that we don't have. And the to the degree that we can realize that, to the degree there will be also a willingness on the side of the Monsantos in the world to join the table and to enter the conversation. But right now, that would not be a situation I would feel called to move inside.
I just have a question. The situation in Syria is very much on my mind, having lived there. And I'm just trying to apply sort of what you've been talking about to the situation. How do you handle a situation where those that are in power are not necessarily rational and don't necessarily want to come to the table?
And not necessarily.
They don't necessarily want to come to the table. I mean, your example for the climate simulation is that those actors came into the room and wanted to address the issue. How do you deal with conflict situations where you have people in power that do not want to relinquish power and don't necessarily want to come to the table? In the meantime, the next generation is being robbed of education or growing up in refugee camps, and so I understand that it takes time, but we're also jeopardizing the next generation.
I'm not an expert on Syria or even on that part of the world. I do know, though, when you read European press, it's a little bit different conveyed than in the American. And I would doubt that it's really true that you have leaders that under no way want to come to the table. You have, however, a very difficult situation. But I think if I have learned one thing in any kind of conflict resolution experience I'm aware of, is that if you have, antagonistic structure between two, it's almost never true, and it's almost never productive. Because reality has many more stakeholders, and the polarization can never be solved just with these two talking to each other. So the trick is to enlarge it, to bring in the real society, not all the, you know, the people who go off and kind of create their own fantasies at the expense of other people's costs. So the trick is to somehow bring in these other voices into the conversation based on which these big players kind of derive their own legitimacy from. So that's, it's not, and that doesn't happen at the top level right away. There's probably a lot of seeding, and then there is a timing. So complex problems require complex solutions. And I think it's probably the groundwork for that and how to, I would doubt, I mean, it's often said, I doubt that even when I read some of the interviews, if I said, they all have their own narrative. It's not true that they are crazy. It's actually, they have their own narrative and rationale why they do what they do. And then when you really focus on that, you need to almost massage. So it's never the case that you come in with the issue that you want to resolve. So you need to, the definition of what the common ground, the platform is about, needs to grow and become more complex such that it creates space for all the key players that you need, that they can see something there that's valuable to them. So it's that kind of, and that would, you know, include the key parties there. I'm not saying, you know, I have anything useful to say really, but I'm just saying what I have seen in other cases. And although it may look like you know, it's completely irrational or not interested in the common good, I would assume that you know, there is a narrative behind there, and the only chance we have is to connect with that narrative and to find out what is driving that narrative, and then, you know, build relationships. We know from all, you know, one thing that I learned, like in change management and organization, is so if you want to change the behavior of someone else and you don't have any power over that person, so what is the first thing that you do? You build the relationship, because without the relationship, the best ideas that you have is completely useless, because they don't connect. So it's that. So, and that's kind of like coming back to the field, the social field, and the field of the farmer. That's the soil work. Right? That's what I had heard my father like talking about 50 years, right? It's all about the quality of the soil, right? And so in our case, what does that mean in the social field? It's the quality of relationship and kind of where do we start with listening? And you know, it's I don't know, it's not very helpful, I know.
I'm curious about something, which is when I think back now, this is going back a ways to like 1970, I thought that then we were on the cusp of some big changes, that with the people waking up to the environment, people had a different consciousness. And I would have been very surprised to try to imagine the world we live in today, 40 plus years later, and sort of, I think in many ways, how backward we've moved. So I ask you, other than the fact, obviously, the awareness of the environment is much greater now, obviously the technology is different now than it was 40 years ago, why should we assume that things will actually get better in the future?
Oh, no, things will get not better at all. Unless we do it. So there's no automatic mechanism. So unless we do it. All I was commenting on is that in the past, it used to be some people thought, like you and I, which is big changes, blah, 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 blah. And then other people think, what are these? What is he talking about? So contesting that. And today, whether it's not just us here, you go to many places, you talk about the current crisis of the moment of disruption. No one is, you know, I have, in many years, no one has challenged me on that. So that used to be quite different in earlier times. That's all I said. So there's like a different collective condition. The collective awareness has shifted. But now, will anything happen? Why should I? There's no, not at all. But we can make it happen. I truly believe in that, and it's like, you know, it's funny, like, because if you look at all these facts and figures, there's only three options: denial, depression, or cynicism, right? That's the menu. But then you connect with certain networks, and if I also really try to monitor my own energy, I am not depressed. I'm not in that much. I'm not always in denial, and cynicism. maybe some, but you know, there's a different energy that I can tap into, that I see many people are tapping into, which is an energy of inspiration, of, you know, that we can make it work. I feel profoundly grateful being on this planet right now, because now is when it happens, when it matters. Kind of now is where kind of it's our generation who actually, I feel, kind of need to make happen something that the generation before us talked about, right, all the big changes. And then, you know, the generation after us, I think we need to give them something, kind of to, like a landing place. Like kind of that they can use to then realize their own aspirations. So I feel, I see that, I experience that kind of energy of people connecting with a sense of future possibility and then making it happen in many places. That inspires me, and that I think is more, so what gives me confidence is, yes, the problems are bigger even than we thought 40 years ago, but the accessibility of this other energy, this energy of a future field of future possibility, is more accessible now, not only for me or us, but you know, for many people. I think it's not, you know, it's not a painful 10-year process you have to go through. No, it's right there, and that makes me very confident. So, but automatically, no, nothing.